In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now the Church in Wales Advent Prayer, firstly in Welsh, then in English. Gweddion. Dad Neville, o roi ti'n olaini ac yn fywyd mewn byd o drallod. Dyro dy iachad i'r rhai sy'n glaf, dy nerth i'r rhai sy'n dioddef, dy dosturi i'r rhai sy'n galaru, ath ddiwerder i'r rhai sy'n gweithio iachau a gwasanaethau eraill. Bendithi y genedl y Cymru ac ysbryd bwy hawl dy gariad, a chaniata i ni dy drygaredd, a ddatgyddiwyd y myrsyn Christ y fab. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in the midst of a troubled world, you are light and life. Send us your healing for those who are ill, your strength for those who are suffering, your compassion for those who grieve, and your courage for those who work for the healing and service of others. Bless our nation of Wales with the life-giving spirit of your love and grant us your mercy revealed in the person of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. And now a reading from the Gospel according to St. Luke. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favoured one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. Well, there was nothing much that I fancied watching on what I call the ordinary TV the other night. So instead, I found myself watching a really fascinating documentary about the Voyager space programme. And I happened to find this on Amazon Prime. Now, for those of a certain vintage, you might remember about the Voyager space programme. It consisted of two spacecraft, imaginatively called Voyager 1 and Voyager 2, and they were both launched in 1977, so 43 years ago, to explore the outer planets of our solar system, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune. Voyager 1 famously carried on it a golden record containing photos, music and messages from Earth, so that any aliens who discovered the craft could find out where it came from. All very well, I always thought, so long as they possessed the right kind of record player. Well, after taking some absolutely amazing and stunning and never before seen so close up photographs of Jupiter and Saturn. Voyager 1 then continued on into outer space, as did its sister Voyager 2 after it had examined Uranus and Neptune. And we were told by NASA in the year 2012 that Voyager 1 had entered what's known as interstellar space, that huge empty blackness in between the stars. And so fascinated by this was I that I looked this morning on the NASA website where they track what Voyager is doing now. It's really interesting. Go and have a look if you've got a moment. Apparently, Voyager 1 is now some 14 billion miles from the Earth. 14 billion miles away. It's travelling at a speed of 38,000 miles per hour and covering 1,000 miles every 2.5 minutes. And you can see it ticking up, the miles ticking up live on the website. It's fascinating. And it's continuing to send data back to us. And propelled by its flyby of those two massive planets, Jupiter and Saturn, in theory, Voyager 1 will continue travelling onward forever, long after human beings have ceased to inhabit the Earth. Well, I tell you all of this not just to share with you what I happened to be watching on TV the other day. I mention it also because it reminds us, doesn't it, of the mind-blowing vastness of our universe, and also of our relative insignificance in the midst of it all. The universe is massive beyond belief, both in size and also in terms of its span of history. In 1990, Voyager 1 took a very poignant photograph looking back on the solar system before its cameras were switched off to conserve energy. At that particular point, it was only 3.7 billion miles from the Earth. And as one of the scientists at the time commented, from that distance, our planet looked like a pale blue dot against the empty expanse of space. Now, often as individuals, we might feel that we are pretty insignificant among all the billions of people who live in our world. Well, I can certainly tell you, you feel even more insignificant after watching a documentary like that. And of course, as Christians, we believe that it's God who created all of this. How he did it, when he did it, how big it is, whether there is life on any of the other planets that Voyager is hurtling towards, and if so, how does God relate to those people? All of these things are profound mysteries that we don't know the answer to. Yet at the centre of all of it is our God. And the truly amazing thing, the thing that has become clear during these weeks of Advent, is that this awesome God chooses to have a relationship with individual human beings like you and me. Insignificant though we may be compared to the cosmos, we matter to God, and he wants to use us to further his purposes in the world. Now, in our first week, we considered the patriarchs and matriarchs of the Old Testament. Abram and Sarai and their family had a nomadic existence, yearning to explore new lands, perhaps a bit like the people behind the Voyager mission. And then, of course, we learned in the story that God chose them out of all the peoples of the earth to go and take possession of the promised land and to found a great nation. Despite their many ups and downs, God continued this personal relationship with the children and then with the grandchildren of Abraham and Sarah, as they later became. So that was our first week. In our second week, then, we considered what the prophets had to say about the coming Messiah. And I was particularly struck then by Isaiah's vision of the suffering servant. Once again, God would choose to work through an individual. But importantly, this individual, the suffering servant, would bring salvation not through military might or through control, but through giving his life for others. And then last week, we saw how God used John the Baptist, that strange Old Testament type prophet, to prepare people for what Jesus was about to do. Yet John knew that the primary focus was not to be on him, but on the one who was coming after him. John certainly had a powerful sense of his own insignificance. It should come as no surprise then that in our final week today, we also have an instance of God choosing an individual to fulfil an important task. The focus this week, of course, is on Mary. But in a reversal of the first week, where I went for equality by including the matriarchs as well as the patriarchs, today I also want to include Joseph. So today I'm including the man as well as the woman. In the first week, I included the women as well as the men. Now, we're so familiar, aren't we, with that beautiful Annunciation story, which was read as the Gospel at Mass yesterday, and then again at our carol service in the evening, and which I read to you just now. Now, often when we reflect or preach on that passage, we focus on Mary's response to the angel, her words, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." It's with those words that Mary demonstrates that she is eager and ready to play her part in God's plan. And in that, she rightly stands as an example for all of us. But I also think it's important to focus on God's initiative in the first place. He chose Mary. He sent the angel Gabriel to tell her what was to happen. As I think I said in a previous week, God could have sent Jesus to the earth Star Trek style, just beamed down. Or he could have not bothered with Jesus at all and simply achieved what he wanted to by decree. But you know, our God is so full of love for us that he wants to involve himself in our world. He wants to become one of us, born in the usual way as a human baby, and he wants to make use of a human mother in order to do this. Now, as promised, I'm going to say a word or two about Joseph. It's true, isn't it, that in Luke's account of Jesus's birth, the focus is very much on Mary, with Joseph playing a supporting part. But in the version we find in Matthew's Gospel, the roles are reversed. Here, it seems, God takes the initiative with Joseph, while Mary is referred to only briefly. Three times in Matthew's story, God speaks to Joseph in a dream. The first time to reassure him about Mary's pregnancy and to persuade him not to divorce her. The second time to warn Joseph to flee with his family to Egypt to escape from Herod. And the third time to tell him that it's now safe to return to Nazareth after Herod's death. Now, all of this, God's interaction with Joseph, again, shows us his love, his concern, his desire to use individuals to fulfil his purposes. But notice, in both instances, in Luke and in Matthew, God never orders, never commands, never compels. Instead, he encourages, he reassures, he cajoles. It's always interesting to me that despite their differences, Matthew's account and Luke's account share an important similarity. The angel in Joseph's dream and the angel Gabriel who speaks to Mary both utter these words, "Do not be afraid." Do not be afraid. These are perhaps the four most reassuring words that anyone can say or that anyone can hear. And not only does God speak these words to Mary and to Joseph, he also speaks them to each of us as well. Now, at this point, of course, you might very well be laughing at me through your screens. "Do not be afraid," you might exclaim. Fine words at the present moment. As I speak, COVID is continuing to run amok, with the new variant causing a rapid increase in cases. Large parts of our United Kingdom, including, of course, all of Wales, are under lockdown for nobody knows how long. What will be the cost of all of this, economically, socially, emotionally? The clock is ticking down towards the deadline for a Brexit deal on the 31st of December, and the future looks so uncertain. There may be many other things causing us to be afraid, whether illness, financial insecurity, or even that sense of our own insignificance as we ponder the vastness of the universe that I mentioned at the start. Does anything I do really matter? We might ask ourselves. But you know, God's words, "Do not be afraid," don't promise to somehow take away all these problems and worries, nor do they guarantee to us an easy life. But what they do tell us is that amazingly, God loves each and every one of us. He values and cherishes us despite all our many faults. He wants to have a relationship with us, and he wants to use us, yes, you and me, in order to further his kingdom of love and peace. This surely is the essence of Advent and the essence of Christmas. At the end of that fascinating programme about Voyager, one of the scientists said this: "Even after the craft has stopped communicating with Earth, about 5 years or so from now, it will just keep on going and going and going and going. In billions and billions of years' time," he said, "everyone alive now will have been forgotten. Maybe the human race itself will have been long forgotten. And yet Voyager will still exist somewhere in space." It's a very sobering thought. But in truth, of course, none of us will be forgotten. Each of us is uniquely known to and loved by God. Each of us has a place with him for eternity. Let us rejoice and give thanks for that, and place our trust in him as we face the new year and our collective future with hope. Gweddion, let us pray. Blessed are you, Sovereign Lord, merciful and gentle. To you be praise and glory for ever. Your light has shone in our darkened world through the childbearing of Blessed Mary. Grant that we who have seen your glory may daily be renewed in your image, and prepared like her for the coming of your Son, who is the Lord and Saviour of all. Blessed be God for ever. People of God, prepare. God above all, maker of all, is one with us in Christ. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. God, the mighty God, bends down in love to earth. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. God with us, God beside us, come soon to the world he has made. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. We are God's children. We seek the coming Christ. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. The Collect for Advent Sunday. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and to put on the armour of light. Now in the time of this mortal life, in which your Son Jesus Christ came to us in great humility, that on the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal, through him who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Ein tad o'r hwnnwt yn y nefwydd, sanctaeddi'r de enw deled de derenas, gwenela de ewellus, megis yn y nef felly ar y ddair hefyd, darwyn ni heddiw ein bara bainyddiol, y maddau i ni ein deledion, fel y maddau yn unau un deledwyr, ac nac arwain ni i brofedigaeth, aeth o'r gwared ni rhag drwg, canesaidd y tu o'r dyrnas a'r gallu a'r gygoniad, yn oes oesoedd. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. May God the Father, who loved the world so much that he sent his only Son, give you grace to prepare for life eternal. May God the Son, who comes to us as Redeemer and Judge, reveal to you the path from darkness to light. May God the Holy Spirit, by whose working the Virgin Mary conceived the Christ, help you bear the fruits of holiness. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Well, thank you everyone for joining me, not only this evening, but all through these 4 weeks of Advent. It's been a wonderful journey, as always, and as again in 2020, so different to what we've been used to, doing it virtually, doing it online, just me speaking into a camera with nobody there. But it's lovely to see all your comments coming up and to know that you are there watching and you're with me in spirit. So thank you for being with me tonight, as I say, and throughout these weeks of Advent. And hopefully look forward to seeing some of you either virtually or in person in the coming days as we prepare to celebrate the wonderful Christmas season. So, diolch yn fawr iawn, keep well, keep safe, North Star.